dreams, you think of the Lord. Isn't that so? Okay, let us stand this morning, call to worship. We may all stand. Welcome again. Before I leave my home this morning, it was fun, yes. There was this little chorus, a lot of churches would sing, it was Holy, 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 Lord Almighty. I think that it is one of Diane's songs too that she will usually sing with us. And after that, in Macintosh came to me and said, the presence of God is with you, Lauren. What's wrong? And it also said, the Holy Spirit is here with you. The Holy Spirit is living with you today. So I want to give God praise, thanks, and honor, and the Holy Spirit by going ahead with what it is said. Holy, 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 Lord is God Almighty. The Lord is here with us. So maybe we could chorus that together. I'm not sure if Pam has that, but it doesn't matter. We make noise and make music with our mouth all the time. So maybe you could join in and say, Holy, 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 Lord Almighty. Our God is here with us. The Holy Spirit is here with us. Because that's what we want. We want that energy with us here this morning. So let us all sing who can sing, who can. It's fine. You will hear the others singing. Holy, holy God
to worship. Our opening prayer this morning. Oh, Holy Lord, you are worthy of all our praises. Your reign in majesty above us and our Lord forever. We thank you for allowing us to be graced by your presence today. allowed to be called by your name. Please accept our love and our adoration in Jesus' name. We are here to pray, Almighty God, that you will always light your way with our way with your presence. We resist evil and pray that your light will shine on us, that people may see your glory through us and come to worship you as the living God. And the people of God say loud and clear, amen. And amen.
We now have sweet, sweet Holy Spirit with you from the UNCH. Tree 4.
Thank you.
seated. It is time for our celebrations and our concerns. We always start with our celebrations. And I don't know if anybody's noticed it, but this is my first anniversary as your pastor. We made it through 2020, 2021. To God be the glory.
Amen.
There's a wonderful gospel song that says, "My soul looks back and wonders how I got over." And it keeps on going. "My soul looks back and wonders how I got over." There was nobody but our God that got us through. To God be the glory. I have some celebrations and concerns here. The first one is someone who is dearly loved, greatly appreciated, incredibly gifted, has retired, and is moving to Florida. Okay, I hope he hasn't entered the bedroom. I don't even going on vacation. But we want to say to our beloved Lester, thank you. Thank you. You have a safe journey. You'll be blessed in this new beginning. And by the way, I'll be calling you in another 4 years because I want to know how you did it. Okay, you have had plenty enough time to show me what to do, how to do it, and when to do it. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. But it does leave us with a little tinge of sadness. But that's all right. You still are. God's prayer is going with you. And something in our hearts. We cannot forget that today we celebrate this nation's Declaration of Independence. Lord knows, God knows, our nation needs His presence. Our nation needs to hear from Him. And we as His nation must be prepared to listen and obey. We praise God for the fact that the troops have been returned home safely from Afghanistan. We still pray for those who are still on active duty. You have someone on active duty. We understand. And we lift our prayers for them. My beloved sister Karen has asked us that we pray for her former husband, John, as he continues to fight a serious illness. She is praying, asking prayers for those who are fighting the big bugaboo that's been bothering us for the last year and a half in COVID. By the way, here's my prayer. I stand with my sister, but here's my prayer also. So now let's talk about this new variant.
Look, enough of this. Enough of this.
It is time for the house of God and the people of God to start saying, "Healer, healer, Jehovah Rapha, come and heal our land." Are there other joys and concerns among us? I'm rejoiced that I get to see some new faces. And I am so excited to see you in person. I have heard about you. But I'm so glad to give you a hug. So to you, welcome home. To God be the glory. Are there other concerns? Are there other celebrations? Come on in, my sister. Come on in. I'm sorry. Should be back. Now, it's time for God's children to talk to their Father in heaven. Shall we begin? Let's bring our hearts and our minds in tune. are the faithful one. And it is our joy and our pleasure to be in your presence. And for this, dear God, we give you thanks. Thanks that we can come to your house and see each other and tell the stories of how we got over and how you have guided us through and how you have kept us going. We acknowledge the fact that there are some that have fallen apart or fallen away, but God, you have kept us together. And for that, we give you the glory, the honor, and the praise. We bring you, Lord, these concerns only because you said you would, that if we brought them to you, you would handle them. So God, for the prayers that have been lifted up, for the prayers in our hearts that we have not spoken out loud, for the joys and the concerns we don't even know are coming, we give you thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you for living with us, guiding us, blessing us, helping us, strengthening us, and keeping us. And we pray for this house, oh God. And we pray for the people who inhabit it. We pray for those who are going on a new stage in their life. Guide them, bless them, and keep them. We pray for our nation. You said that the righteous ones should pray for the nations. It's why we're put here. And so God, as you look and you see all that is happening and that is not happening, Lord, let your Holy Spirit run through this nation, break the chains, break the bonds of fear and doubt and hatred, and loose those people that are bound by those things. We ask this in the name of Jesus. And look for every soul that's looking to find the answers of how do we live in these days. Give us the anointing to say, I know a Savior, and he is the way, the truth, and the life. Lord, for our children, thank you for those little gifts. Thank you that you allow them to reach adulthood. For our little ones that are still on the journey, we pray that you cover them, that you dispatch your angels to walk with them, before them, and above them. Keep them safe and give them wisdom and understanding to know the right from the wrong and the courage to walk in the right. Give your larger children, your bigger kids, the courage to walk in the light. And our light is you, Lord Jesus. Guide us, bless us, and keep us. In Jesus' name. Come by here, my Lord, come by here. Come by here, my Lord, come by here. Come by here, my Lord, come by here. Oh, Lord, come by here. Come on. Come by here, my Lord, come by here. Come by here, my Lord, come by here. Come by here, my Lord, come by here. Oh, Lord, come by here. And God's people said,
amen.
And amen.
Yeah, this one now. The night is far gone, the day is near. Let us then lay aside the works of darkness and put on the armor of light. Let us live honorably as in the day, not in reveling and drunkenness, not in debauchery or lasciviousness, not in quarreling and jealousy. Instead, put on the Lord Jesus Christ and make no provision for the flesh to gratify its desires. This is the word of God.
Thanks be to God.
Now, my second reading is from Galatians chapter 3, verses 12 to 15. As God chosen ones holy and beloved, clothe yourselves in compassion, kindness, humility, meekness, and patience. Bear with one another, and if anyone has a complaint against another, forgive each other. Just as the Lord has forgiven you, so you also must forgive. Above all, clothe yourselves with love, which binds everything together in perfect harmony. And let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, to which indeed you are called in one body. And be thankful. Amen.
Amen.
We have a request for a hymn from the Faith We Sing. It's not written in your bulletin. 2168, Love the Lord Your God. So we all can stand and sing this. Then our pastor will do our sermon. Okay?
Thank you.
Most of us have been brought up in a time when we celebrate by placing our hand over our heart and saying the Pledge of Allegiance to the flag. And recently, in the news, a young lady who, in protest to some of the things that are not perfect about this beloved nation of ours, well, she got fried. The media fussed and cussed and called her all sorts of names and told her she was just not who she should be, and she was unfaithful and unloyal and just, they were horrible. You know, when you make a statement that reminds us to be our better selves, sometimes you make the people who aren't comfortable with the change in your heart angry and scared, and they can use their violence with their words and their actions. And this young lady was protesting and saying, I love America, but this is not right. And she had a list of things. And it got me to thinking, over the last couple of years, this nation has been talking about the flag and about the Pledge of Allegiance to the flag, and how sometimes it's been a protest because some people have kneeled rather than stood there with their heart over their hands. But I want you to understand something. That particular act and that particular practice, placing your hand over your heart, is less than 70 years old. Pledging allegiance to the flag is less than 70 years old. And it started, first of all, little lesson. It started during the time of the Civil War, after the Civil War, when everybody wanted to know whose side you won. Are you a Yankee or are you a Confederate? And so the soldiers had to say this pledge and tell who they belonged to, where was their allegiance, where was their commitment, where would they stand, and who would they fight for. This pledge, this covenant, we need to understand when we are making this pledge, we are making a covenant. Covenants aren't something new, they're a part of the way we deal with each other. This is not the first covenant that we've made. It's not the last covenant that we've made. All of our relationship with God is based on this thing called a covenant. That's where I promise you something, and you promise me something. And we will fight tooth, nail, claw, and tail to keep those promises to each other. There's another covenant that we make, it's called marriage. And you stood before a holy person and you said, I promise to be with you until the day you die. I will fight with you, I will fight for you, I will stand with you. And we happen to throw God into it every now and then. But our greatest covenant as the sons and daughters of God is the covenant that we make with the Lord Jesus Christ when we say, Lord Jesus, I acknowledge my sin. Please forgive me. Come into my heart. I accept you as Lord and Savior. You see, when you said that, when you made that statement, you made a covenant with the greatest, the mightiest, the strongest, the one who transcends all national commitments, the one who transcends all small covenants. You made a covenant with the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And the reason he is called the Lord of Lords is that's who he is. Above our national concerns, above the petty little things that we think we have to pay attention to. As you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, all your soul, and all your mind. This is the great and the first commandment. So I would like to talk to the sons and daughters of God about their allegiance. There are going to be so many things that are going to pull in your allegiance to God. You must fit in. You must be like the other people. And in the time when Paul wrote these letters, this is nothing new. You see, by the time Paul is writing the letters that he's writing, Rome is demanding that you worship the Caesar as God. Somewhere along the line, this kingdom, this Roman king, got this interesting idea that he was divinely blessed and he should be divinely worshipped, and everybody should fall at their feet. Take this moment of absolute allegiance and promise him that there would be no issues, there would be no uprisings, because to do so would be to dishonor their great and mighty king. And for the Christians of that day, they were saying, excuse me, Caesar, you might be king of the largest empire in the world, but you are not my Lord. My Lord is Jesus Christ. So this having to choose between whether you will love your nation before you love your God is nothing new. And in this day and age, it has been so easy to try and mingle and intermix those two things. Well, if you love your nation, if you love God, you love your nation. And Paul is reminding the people of God, and I remind the people of God here, we have a dual citizenship. Yes, we are citizens or seeking citizenship in this particular nation. We belong somewhere. Which some of us are trying to get to the point where we belong here. But above all, it doesn't matter where you go, it doesn't matter what green card you carry, if you are a child of God through your confession to Jesus Christ, your first loyalty is to the Lord Jesus. He comes first. So when you get in those situations where you are being said, it is being said to you, choose. For thus, who have been saved and delivered and healed and blessed and guided and kept and loved and transformed by the grace of God through the Lord Jesus Christ, there is no other person we worship and fall down before. Jesus Christ, yesterday, today, and forever. We pledge our allegiance to the Lord Jesus. Now, I understand that there are going to be things that are going to try and pull us away from that. That's just being human. Because nobody likes to think that they are controllable. Because when you are in a covenant relationship and the partner decides to pull at you and demand things of you that your King, your Lord, and your Savior has asked of you, do you see the difference? You see, anyone less than God will demand. But our relationship with Jesus Christ has always been an invitation. And we answer that invitation for one reason. Because we know without a shadow of a doubt, without a question, without a challenge, without wondering, although I get there are some days where I wonder. But at the end, here's what I know. Jesus Christ today, Jesus Christ tomorrow, and Jesus Christ forever and ever. And to God be the glory. Because regardless of what's going on in your national area, Jesus Christ is our King. No matter what will pull at you, and there seems to be this surge of nationalism. And some of the things that we might be asked to do are going to be in direct conflict with the love of God and our assignment as citizens of heaven. Here's the deal. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, all your soul, all your mind. This is the first commandment, and the second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. The litany goes on to say, on these two things hang all the law and the prophets. And then you go on and you say, glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost. I would invite us to remember this morning, particularly as we are celebrating our nation's birth. Remember, who's your first allegiance to? Who gets your first prayers? Who gets your first fidelity? Remember whose you are. Yes, we live on this planet. Yes, we have work to do. And yes, we have a gospel to preach and a God to glorify. But we also live in a nation that sometimes may be hostile because it's going to require us. When you preach the gospel, it is going to require hearts and minds to examine themselves. And here's the sad, here's the difficult thing. When we look at the not-so-pretty inside of us, we don't like it. And we have this human tendency, if we don't like it, we'll ignore it. We'll deny it. And if it really starts pulling and tugging at our spirit and our heart, some of us will fight it. There will be resistance. But the song says, seeking first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added unto you. So while we have to live on this planet, seeking first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, remember the promises and the pledges of allegiance that you made to the Lord your God. You know, the one who woke you up this morning. The one who guides you and blesses you and keeps you and holds you together when you feel like you're going to fall apart. The one who loves you when you aren't so pretty. The one whose love doesn't fluctuate just because. Seek ye first the kingdom of God. So my beloved brothers and sisters in Christ, as we, God help us, watch the news, and we see all of that we see, and we're wondering, where is our nation going? We who are the sons and daughters of God are called to do one thing. We are called to pray for our nation. And this is not the first time that the call for prayer has been for our nation. Israel, as we knew it in the scriptures, the Lord said to him, if my people, who are called by my name, will humble themselves and seek my face, I will hear from heaven and I will heal their land. So we already have an assignment. I contend that the most patriotic thing that you could possibly do is simply to pray for your nation. Paul goes on in different writings and he talks about how do you live for Christ in an unchrist-like world. He said it wouldn't be easy. And it seems like it's getting harder and harder. And there are so many things that are pulling on our alliance to the Lord Jesus. But don't let go. Don't let anything pull you away from the Lord Jesus. Don't let anything pull you away from the loving God that has kept you from the time you left your mother's womb to this very day and will keep you until the day you stand before him and hear, well done, good and faithful servant. So my encourage to the people of God is this. Don't let go. Don't stop praying. There are going to people that are going to say, oh, the whole thing's going to Hades in the handbasket. Sons and daughters of God have been. Yes, God himself has promised us the victory. We have dual citizenship. I invite us, when you have one nation that you so love or so many that you love, keep on praying. Because the prayers of the righteous are effective and powerful. And God knows so many of our nations, so many of our places, so many of our people so desperately need to know that there is a God who loves them. And we are his ambassadors. So my prayer for you, my beloved brothers and sisters, is this. May the grace, love, joy, and peace that is yours through the risen Savior guide your words, protect your thoughts, and keep your mind in perfect peace. May you be able to carry out your dual citizenship in a way that gives God the glory. May the Holy Spirit direct you so that you are earthly good and heavenly bound. So that when people have transactions with you and interactions with you, they understand I am talking to someone who knows the love of God. And there's something different about us. We have to remember this. There are going to be things that are going to try and pull us to call us into just the ordinary. But we have an extraordinary God, and he has given us an extraordinary assignment, and he gives us extraordinary strength to say the words, God loves you. And it's real simple. We know this. God's love is what conquers all. So to the people of God, both here in this house, to the people of God who will listen to this service afterwards, you just remember who gets your first allegiance. Joshua says, choose you this day whom you will serve. And the angel says, for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. Amen.
Amen.
And amen. Let the church say amen. Let the church say amen. God has spoken. Let the church say amen. Let the church say amen. Let the church say amen. Please know that my wish would be that you are growing in grace moment by moment, day by day, that you are coming to discover the steadfast, unforgettable, undeniable love of the Lord Jesus Christ, and that his heart is His love is setting your heart on fire and passion. You want to be the best you can be. But I also understand this. To walk, to live, to love, and to serve the Lord Jesus in a world that is hostile to your faith and your weakness. It is not easy. But I invite you into a relationship with someone who loves you more than anyone ever could. I invite you to know the height, the depths, and the widths of the love, Jesus Christ. And if you are in need of prayer, just slip up your hand. And your son and your sisters and your brothers will pray with you and for you. Amen. As we sing, I surrender all, hymn number 354. Let us stand for those who can. Lord, thank you for honoring our sacrifice and our lives with your kindness and mercy. Please accept these gifts with our gratitude and wonder at how amazing you are. Bless these gifts that we may be witnesses to others of your grace, your mercy, and your love. Come on, your covenant. God's people say it.
Amen.
Amen. You may be seated, my beloved. We renew our covenant with him, but we also renew our covenant with each other. And there is a song that says, I pray for you, you pray for me, I need you to survive. And we all need to be praying for each other. Because on this corner, we are the church. We are the witness. And God is amazing. So I take us back to that first night. The disciples are gathered around Jesus. Jesus knows good full well what's going to happen in the next 72 hours. And he gives us something to remember him by. First he starts with the bread, and he breaks it, and he says, this is my body which is broken for you. As often as you do this, remember me. And then he took the cup, and whether it was the bread or the cup, our Lord Jesus gave thanks to the Father, and he said this of the cup. This cup is my blood of the new covenant. Take, drink, and as often as you drink this, so in the next few moments, we're going to invite you to examine your heart. Because God calls us to this table with clean hearts and clean hands. And so, in the silence, in this moment, I invite you to look at your hearts. Search yourself, God. And if there is anything in there that is not like you, if there is any thought that is more important than our devotion to you, expose it and remove it in Jesus' name. Lord, search our hearts. And if we've given place to something that is not you, if we've let something be more important to us than you are, Lord, forgive us. We renounce those things in the name of Jesus, and we place you on the throne, and we call you Lord, and we thank you for this blessing of table. Bless these elements. Bless the people of God who remember whose we are. We are yours. My beloved brothers and sisters in Christ, the Lord's table is open and all are welcome. So as you follow the directions of this wonderful sister who stepped in to be our usher for this day, come and let us receive together as our brother plays for us.
Thank you.
We have received the cup and we have received the bread, and I invite you to go in the grace, hope, joy, mercy, and peace that is ours through the Lord Jesus Christ. And I'll see you at this table this time next month. Amen.
Amen.
Let's go.
in joy, go in peace, and also go remembering whose you are. Amen?
Amen.
And amen. I need to speak with the certified lay speakers. If they meet me in this pew or here for a moment, I would really appreciate it.
Yeah.